Hello everyone, once again, good evening to all of you. Warm welcome to day two of the scientific sessions of the Oral Cancer E-Conclave. I, on behalf of Sterling Cancer Hospital, Foundation for Head and Neck Oncology and Innovative Cancer Care, thank all the participants who are here with us on different social media platforms. I'm sure that we are going to learn a lot more new things on today's session, because it is going to be a great discussion with the lot of panelists here on board, and elite doctors from across the country have joined us to impart us grave knowledge about the subject. I once again thank all the partnering organizations and the representatives who are here with us today for real tirelessly working to make this event really successful. I thank all the chairperson, speakers, and panelists who have given us their valuable time on this Sunday, on this beautiful Sunday.
Now move on to the very interesting panel discussion. And I really feel short of words to introduce the moderator of this panel, Dr. Anil Dikrus, sir, a very dynamic surgeon. And I really don't know what would be the appropriate word to invite him, but he is a very dynamic surgeon, the UICC president. And straightforward to you, sir.
Thanks, Pooja. And thanks to the organizers for a great program. Am I heard? Am I seen? Is my slide shared?
Sir, you're very much seen. I just request you to keep this as F5. Full screen, your PPT.
Absolutely. Hang on, I'll do that right away. The thing is that I was making slides, so if I put it on F5, I don't know what's coming next, but perfect. So thank you, organizers, for a great program. Congratulations to ICANN Care. I think, Pavan, your leadership is really putting head and neck tobacco control on the national agenda, and I congratulate you and your team for putting this together along with the leaders in Sterling Cancer Hospitals and, of course, our very own FHNO. We've got 1 hour. I've got a number of panelists, majority surgical oncologists. I have Karnav, who's a plastic surgeon. I'm quickly going to call out the names. And if everybody is there, you all can just say yes so that I know you are there. Saurav Gupta, Sharad Desai, Neeti Kapre, Rajiv Sareen, Jayesh Prajapati, Yusuf Memon. Yes. Are all the surgeons there, please?
Yes, sir.
Yes, it's...
Now, great. We've got Vanita, who's a radiation oncologist from Max. I've known for long. We've got Karnav Panchal, who's the plastic surgeon, and Anuradha, who's the radiologist. Are three of you all there as well?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, great. It sounds limited. It's a very, very large topic. And I think the first two speakers have made my job very easy. I'm not going to direct questions to anybody in particular. I would request any of you all to chip in whenever you want to. And try not repeating so that we can cover more points. I'd also request Rishabh to screen the chat box, and if there are any questions that need to be answered, you can either WhatsApp it to me or you can interject and ask, and we can put them to the panels. Yes, so my call with the organizers were to discuss a little bit about the neck, why, when, and what, and they've put that up twice in their pamphlet. You can see it on line 1. And then again, and the bullet 5. So neck is going to form an important part of our discussion. Defining the early cancer, clinical radiologic, Dipendra has already spoken on. I'll allude to a few points from what he's spoken. Approaches, since we are majority surgeon, intraoral, extraoral. Something about margins and why the fuss about margin. And lastly, the path challenges and the need for adjuvant. And again, Devendra briefly alluded to a number of points, and we can see that the literature is a little gray, but we've got Vanita, who will be able to help answer us, and we've also got Pooja, the coordinator, who can chip in at any time. So Neeti, thanks for this slide. And this, according to AJCC, is early cancers. So we are going to focus on clinical T1, T2 cancers, and we'll see how other parameters come into the early oral cancers. So I think all my panelists will agree that this is what we need to discuss today. This is like when you play IPL, the first few balls are very, very easy. The team kind of loosens up. And this is something we know. Early stage disease is treated with single modality therapy, either surgery or radiotherapy. Now we know that surgery is simple, it's fast, it can be repeated. We don't charge as much as radiation oncologists. We don't need great setups. And I'm going to ask any of our panelists, maybe I'll start with Neeti, since she's, I think, the only lady surgeon on the panel. Neeti, when would you send your patient for radiotherapy with an early T1, T2 oral cavity cancer? Or would you not send any?
Right, sir. Just as you said, majority will we will be able to deal with surgery without any significant cosmetic or functional outcome. But there will be few, like a very superficial, lip cancer, which might leave a very bad cosmetic defect if we were to go in surgically. So these would be the kind of tumors that I would like to refer to the radiation oncologist. Anything else in the buccal mucosa or the tongue, I think surgery would be our best option. Although cure rates in early are comparable, but logic drives you to do surgery apart from when it's going to cause a cosmetic or functional issue.
So if I can understand you right, in your practice at the Neeti clinics, out of 100 patients with early cancers, 99 would go for surgery and 1 would go for radiotherapy?
Absolutely.
Okay, lovely. Do all the other surgeons agree with what Neeti said? If there's anybody who disagrees, please make your point. Otherwise, I'm going to pass to Karnav, the plastic surgeon, to make a point on what he feels will be cosmetically or functionally a problem in the lip, which he cannot fix. Any surgeon wants to disagree or add anything to what Neeti said?
Yeah, sir. I would like to add, sir, that in other those patients who are morbid and surgery cannot be done, in those patients also we can give radiotherapy.
You mean morbid means a risk for surgery, anesthesia risk?
Anesthesia and surgical risk, very old patients where the proliferative lesion is there, small proliferative lesion, and they are not fit for anesthesia.
You know, this sometimes seems a Yeah, go ahead. Can you all just state your name? I could recognize Rajiv's voice. Just state your name because others won't know who's speaking. You know, the rest of the audience.
Right.
Go ahead, please. Okay, if I can come in, Rajiv, I'm not sure I agree with you that a patient who is unfit for surgery is going to tolerate a full course of radiotherapy or brachytherapy. You'll need anesthesia for brachy, and giving 6 weeks of radiotherapy is equally toxic. Vanita, a patient unfit for surgery, would you take onto your radiation protocol?
We want to cure this patient with early disease. It has essentially brachytherapy. This cannot be cured with external RT or proton therapy. That is our question. And for doing brachytherapy, this patient has to be fit for anesthesia.
Yeah, so I think the answer about the unfit patient is something we all told in MS and MCH, but now that doesn't hold. So I think I'd agree with Neeti. It's basically a two subsites in the oral cavity that I would send patients for radiotherapy. One is superficial lesions on the palate, and the second is superficial large lesions on the lip, which involve the commissure. Karnav, comments on what you find is the most difficult to reconstruct in the lip.
Sir, if you look at the lip, the upper lip and the lower lip are different. The upper lip is more important for your animation purpose, and the lower lip is more structure which needs to be static. So if you look at the principles of the lower lip reconstruction, we want a lower lip which should be tighter.
Yeah.
If you have a lower lip, best to reconstruct it in such a way that it remains tight. And the use of slings are better in lower lip defects, so that you make sure that the drooling is limited. And as far as possible, we should also try to reconstruct the commissures when they are injured. protect the amount, the commissions, and the, if they remain competent, the functional results are better. And the lower lip is such a defect wherein if there is an isolated lower lip defect, reconstructed with local tissues, which gives nice outcomes, and the surgery is straightforward and it doesn't take.
Okay, Karna. So here are two classical cases that I would say that need to go for radiotherapy. A very superficial lesion involving the entire lip. And here is a very superficial palatal lesion. If I had to operate this, I'll have to take out part of the bone and make an oroantral fistula. This can be treated with nice surface radiotherapy. And this one can be treated with brachytherapy. And I'm just showing you the final outcome on a lip, which had this kind of a lesion. And however good a surgeon you are, this is superficial. If it's a deep lesion, it's not going to work. And here you can see the final outcome. So youngsters who are listening to us, superficial lesions, which could be functionally or cosmetically a problem, lip and palate, no bone involvement, I would send to my radiation oncologist. And I would agree with Neeti that 95% of our patients with oral cavity would come for surgery as the prime modality in early cancers. Any panelist wants to add anything, disagree with my conclusions? Now is your chance on this point. At least say yes or no. At least say yes, some of you all. I'll move to the next.
So just a word of caution with the palatal lesions, that a good discussion with the radiologist to pull out bony invasion, of course, before we take a call.
Yeah, of course. That's true that there should be no bone involvement. We next come to the second issue that I've been asked to cover, and that's margins. I've shown small cancers on the two photographs on the right, one being operated, and then you can see the defect. So I'm going to take the first margin, the first question, and I'm going to now probably ask who, Saurabh can speak or Sharad can speak, what is the optimum margin for an early oral cancer?
Hi, sir. Dr. Saurabh here. So according to different studies, it can vary from 3 millimeter to 5 millimeters.
So tell me, what did we go back and do? We are not going to keep a study in front of us. How do you decide whether it should be 3, whether it should be 5? What do you do in your practice?
I will aim at 5 if there is no structure which cannot be sacrifice. So I will aim at 5 millimeter as the final margin, sir. But I would be happy if it even turns out to be 4 millimeter or 3 millimeter. I won't be revising it post-operatively. Okay.
Anybody else wants to make a comment that Saurabh would aim for 5, but he would accept 3? Anybody wants to qualify this? Sharad, you want to make a point? Jayesh, if you are there, you can chip in.
Yes, sir. I would always try to get a 5 millimeter margin as much as possible. Okay. Because
go ahead, Sharad.
We would want to try to achieve a curative margin. Even when it is very close to the bone or something, even if it is close to the bone, probably if it is touching the bone or something, I will not compromise for the margin. I might do a marginal mandibulectomy in such instances.
So would you then disagree with Jayesh? Jayesh is going to accept 4 millimeters because he doesn't want to do a marginal mandible. You want to do 5 millimeters, so you'll do a marginal mandible. Do I check you right?
Apart from this...
Geographically, the margins are going to vary.
So what do we tell? Hello? 200 odd people listening to us? Give us some clear points, any one of y'all. What is the optimum margin?
Five millimeter would be the optimum margin.
5 millimeters.
Yes.
Okay. Great. So here is the data that tells us that we should have 5 millimeters. Carolyn Anderson's paper, a meta-analysis of margin size and local recurrence in oral squamous cell carcinoma five studies identified, and these are patients without adjuvant therapy. And you can see that the recurrence rates were pooled to give a 21% absolute risk reduction. Look at the p-value. There is 1, 2, 3, 4, 1 in local recurrence with a margin greater than 5 millimeters. So while I agree with Saurabh's comments that there are studies that shows you can take a less margin, by and large, please aim for a 5 millimeter margin. But again, I will agree with Saurabh, if I'm getting a 5 millimeters on all sides, I'm getting a 4 millimeters, I will not take out the bone as a marginal for that extra 1 millimeter. I would accept 4 millimeters for a very small T1 disease. If I can take out structures which are not going to add to morbidity or to the complexity of my surgery, I would aim for 5 millimeters. Everybody agrees? Anybody wants to disagree? Please make your comment now.
Sir,
say that yes, again.
Yeah, I just want to, so Dr. Saurabh here, I just want to ask one question actually. That most common scenario that sometimes we face is buccinator involvement. The report says, or clinically we feel cheek skin is closed. But even if we take a thinner cheek flap, we can take 3 or 4 millimeter margin, and removing the cheek skin would make it 5. So is it justified to remove that part of skin and put a bipedal flap, or do away with the 3 or 4 millimeter margin and save the cheek skin?
So excellent. Are you asking me this, or would you like someone else to answer it from
anybody,
the panel?
Sir, anybody.
Yeah, anybody from the panel wants to answer it? Dr. Chaukar, if he is there, he can come in. He's done some work with his fellow Dr. Shilpi on assessing this thickness. Then I can make some concluding. Is Devendra there, please? Can you unmute him and can he make some comments? Any of the other panelists? Rajiv, Jayesh, Neeti?
Yes, if vaccinator is involved in that case, if vaccinator is involved in that case, just taking subcutaneous fat, and that there, if I can achieve 3 millimeter margin, that should be sufficient.
Yeah, so Saurabh, to answer the question, I would accept a 3 to 4 millimeter margin rather than hack out skin. Exactly the same point that I made for the bone. Because if you remove a through and through skin defect, you get a horrible cosmetic deformity. But you should be very, very careful. If I'm sure that the tumor is very close to the subcutaneous, I remove the skin. So sometimes it's difficult to assess whether the skin is involved clinically and not radiologically. So I take consent for skin and excision. I tattoo the skin loss before I start the operation. I raise the flap, and if I find when I'm raising it, I palpate. If I feel that there's a good soft tissue sitting above the tumor, I go ahead and protect the skin. Otherwise, I remove the skin, and I would accept a 1 millimeter less margin to save the skin. And depending on other factors, decide whether the patient needs radiotherapy. Comments from any panelists, or we'll move to the next question. Anybody wants to add anything? Okay.
Somesh, so in that case, the margin would be labeled pathologically as closed.
No, why would they say that? They would say it's 4 millimeters from the tumor. From the base is 4 millimeters. So,
do you need to take your radiation oncologist on board to make this a kind of a protocol that it's less than 5 millimeters, more than 2 millimeters, but less than 5 millimeters. Early tumors, you would not need adjuvant radiation.
What would you do in your practice, Somesh, if it was 4 millimeters? Would you give all patients radiation?
No, I would not.
Then why do you want a protocol now? Vanita, well, you may want to answer.
So what happens is that there are many centers practicing oral cancer surgery who do not have an in-house radiation oncology department. And many of these patients might end up with adjuvant radiation. So that's a message for everyone. So
I made that point that we would accept a 4 millimeter margin on bone and skin, and we would not do anything for our patient. I'm putting up a Memorial Sloan Kettering study. Snehal Patel's team, they did JAMA head and neck June of 2017. And they're looking at close margins for oral tongue cancer. And they show that patients with a margin of 2.3 to 5 had similar survival control rates as those with greater than 5. And here is the chart that you can see. Those between 0.01 and 2.2 had a higher recurrence rate. So the point I'm making to the entire audience, don't go with your vernier calipers and say that if it's less than 5, you need radiotherapy. If they have bad prognostic factors, your surgery is clean. Your surgery is clean. You have taken 1 millimeter less in the interest of the patient's function or cosmesis. You know that everything else is okay. I would observe that patient. I would definitely observe the patients. Corollary, if I know I'm going to give the patient post-operative radiotherapy because a single node is positive, I'd again not remove skin because I know the primary and the neck would be covered, but I will not have margins of 1 millimeter and expect my radiation oncologist to sterilize it. So that is my point and my philosophy when I treat. Vanita, would you like to make some points, please?
I agree. I think we as radiation oncologists have taken a longer time to understand this concept. Earlier, majority of us will believe that any margin less than 5 millimeter was an indication for radiation therapy. But now in the era of more multimodality and tumor board discussions, we understand this perspective. And as long as margins are not positive, every close margin is not an indication for radiation therapy. Can I ask a question, Dr. DeVries?
Yeah, sure.
Comfortable are you in revising your margins? Suppose intraoperatively you do frozen section. I know some of you do it, some of you don't do it. But in case you do a frozen section.
So Vanita, here is my next question. Now the next two bullets I want someone to take together. If your margin is close, would you revise it? Yes or no? And do you use frozen sections to decide? And that's exactly what Vanita is asking. So let me see. I've not heard Jayesh's voice yet. And Yusuf.
Vanita, I would like to answer this question.
Who's this?
Yeah, Sharad. Because I lost out on the last question.
Go ahead, Sharad.
Yeah, basically, I would say that we almost use frozen section exclusively in head and neck cancer. In today's world, it is probably not appropriate to operate on head and neck cancer without a frozen section. That is my personal view. And I am saying that it is a very low risk setting.
Okay.
So I think basically, even if when you showed the last slide, we cannot just take a 3 millimeter margin and be satisfied with it, because errors are bound to occur and we might have some judgment.
So, Sharad, in the interest of time, you always use frozen section and you will revise the margin if it is close or positive. Am I correct?
Yeah, definitely.
So that's the point you're making. May I please request people who are not speaking to mute themselves and unmute themselves when you want to speak? Because I can hear some children in the background and some hum and various other things. Please unmute yourself when you want to speak. So Sharad will always use frozen and revise margin. Comments from other surgeons, Jayesh and Yusuf.
Yes, sir. I am Dr. Yusuf Miman. We also use frozen section at our hospital, but not always. Clinically, also, it is a private hospital. So sometimes by judging our clinical sense also, we do surgery. But when we are having any doubt, we definitely go for frozen.
Okay. Anybody who doesn't do frozen, Neeti, you all have frozen. Would you always do frozen?
Right. So I just wanted to come back with that point that our institute does not have a frozen section facility. So we have literature from Tata Memorial itself, which says that a gross examination by a surgeon for a margin greater than 7 millimeters is a good enough a judgment, and frozen section is not going to add anything over and above that. Whenever we get a close margin, sir, it's because of either of the two things. It's either an aggressive biology with invading tumor fronts beyond the margin, palpable margin of the tumor, or because it's been a technical snag during resection. Revising a close margin requires you to either label it before you've actually excised the specimen, because otherwise there's no way to tell from the defect which was the particular margin that would come close. It's nearly impossible. And there have been errors ranging from 0 to 1 centimeters when people try to revise margins. Frozen section, yes, is a good tool, but how does it impact outcomes? Like something that was R1 previously and frozen section converted into an R0 will never have equivocal outcomes for something that was R0 to begin with. So I think we as an institute who do not practice frozen section do not think that it's an absolute requirement to do good oral cancer surgery.
And you all take a 7 millimeter margin, or you are just quoting theory?
No, sir, just quoting theory. We will go at least 1 centimeter margin.
Don't quote theory, because unless you do it, because many people will come out with their vernier calipers and say Tata said 7 millimeters throughout the frozen section. Let's discuss something which is robust. So if you believe it, then you say it.
So, sir, anything which is a gross examination by a surgeon, unless there's a significant submucosal aspect to the disease, I think if you place your knife at 1 to 1.5 centimeters, that's...
Boy, here we are discussing on 4 millimeters. If we go 1.5 centimeters, we'll have to move the plastic surgeon in, Neeti. If you're going to do 4 margins at 1.5 centimeters, that's at least 6 centimeters for all tongue cancers.
Sir, there will be a 30% tumor shrinkage.
That's so, not theory. You tell me where you put your knife.
1 centimeter, sir.
1 centimeter. Okay, great. Anybody else wants to do anything else? Okay, we'll go to the frozen section thing and we'll look at data. So, Neeti is correct. Tumor shrinks by about a third, about a centimeter. I'll give you all 2 points that I do. Your floor of mouth lesions will shrink more than the tongue when you cut it. So, on your floor of mouth, take a millimeter extra. So, what looks like 6 or 8 millimeters when you place your knife will become 5 or 4 on the floor of mouth. That's my personal observation. So, Neeti is right. It does shrink. So, you need to go about 2.5 centimeters more than 5 for you to get clear margins. Early lesions shrink more than more advanced lesions. But here is a meta-analysis looking at a clearance of positive margins with frozen sections. And this is from Mustafa Bulbul and others. And why I put this up is that our publication with our data from Tata's, which I did with my fellow Dr. Priya Prathamesh and myself, contributed to the raw data of this study. So there were 8 studies. And like Neeti told you, they looked at R0. They looked at R1 that then we revised to R0. And final R1 were included. And this was all raw data. It wasn't from publications. The R1 to R0 had worse control rates compared to clean R0. Patients who had R1 had the worst prognosis. When compared to final R1, the initial R1 to R0 only showed a trend towards better loco-regional free survival. So this meta-analysis tells us that revision of margins from positive to clear based on FS guidance, please concentrate on the red fonts
does not equate to an initially negative margin and does not significantly improve local control. So we cannot definitely conclude that there is no role for frozen section. For youngsters who are not working in frozen section areas, you may take a margin more than 5 millimeters. I may not be as generous as Neeti and go 1.5. I'll go about 8 millimeters to a centimeter using my judgment on areas where taking out a little more does not compromise to function. So if I had to take a 1 centimeter and remove the tip of the tongue, I won't do it. I'll go 6 or 7 millimeters away and accept that margin. So don't be absolutely sacrosanct coming with your vernier calipers, measuring 5, making an incision, and converting a positive to negative does not improve. And this is because of biological aggressiveness. So remember, please plan your incision properly and treat your patient. I always do frozen, not to judge how much to remove. I believe in this Bulbul's meta-analysis and things like that, but I do it more out of the kind of patients that I see to have more peace at night when the margin finally will come negative. If it comes close on histopath and they take a second opinion, people will say, I don't know what Dr. DeCruz is doing. So I just do it more out of a medico-legal surety. Comments from others? I can see Sharad has raised his hand. Comments from Sharad?
Sir, I would also add that the smaller the lesion, probably would like to be a little more easy on the margins. But if the lesion is bad and deep, probably I would like to take a little more margins. So if it's, let us say, even a 1 centimeter lesion.
Yeah. Yeah, granted, Sharad, I would agree with you and I think all would agree. Any other comments from the panelists? Anybody else wants to make? Rajiv has been very quiet. Vanita wants to make any comments on this thing?
Dr. DeCruz, so far we have always understood that for a R1 resection or a positive cut margin, when we talk of adjuvant treatment, we talk of adjuvant CT-RT, then RT alone. Now, with this data showing that patients who were initially R1 and they later became R0 after margin revision do as bad as initial R1 patients, close to that, do these patients warrant adjuvant radiation or additional chemo?
So, an excellent point. I would have brought it up in my adjuvant discussion, but I know we are not going to get there because I've got more than 70 issues in oral cancer. I think as you get older, you have more doubts or more clarities and more things you want or more contentious issues. But yes, Vanita, if I have operated a patient and the patient comes with a margin negative, even if it's small, a margin close, which has been revised to a negative margin, I will always radiate this patient, particularly if they come to me for a second opinion. So here's what I do. I would see who has operated the patient. If I feel that the patient has been operated by a well-trained head and neck surgeon, and then he has revised the margin and is very, very sure that he has got out all tumors, I may withhold radiotherapy in small lesions. And I'll tell you why. All surgeons who are on the panel and surgeons listening to us will tell you that they have a technical error of judgment one out of every 15, 20, 30 cases. You think you're wide, you'll find the base close. You think you're wide and you'll find the floor of mouth. It's not that you'll always get a 5 millimeter clear margin. It happens once every 30, 40 cases. It doesn't happen daily, but it does happen. So in that case, if you revise, because it's a technical, what Neeti made a very, very valuable point. If it's technical, then I will withhold radiotherapy. But if I know I have operated with absolutely no blood loss, taken out a nice good tumor, it's creeping submucosally and coming close to the margin, comes positive on or close on final, that patient will get radiotherapy in my book. Does that answer, Vanita, the question that you raised? And I'd like my other co-panelists to make any comments.
Agreed, sir.
Okay, great. My last question, which margins do you do? There's so many margins. There's a superior, there's an inferior, there's a medial, there's a lateral, there's a base. So the guys who are doing frozen section, Sharad, does your person sample all five? There's a bone margin, there's a mucosa margin, and there's a soft tissue margin. And so you'll have three margins in five directions, which are 15. Which margin does your frozen section sample? Sharad, has he disappeared? Anybody?
Sir, can I make a comment?
Sir, actually, this is a very nice question to ask. Then again, just like us, even the pathologist has... Hello?
Yeah, go ahead, Sharad.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, Sharad.
Can you hear me?
Very well.
Yeah, just like the surgeon. Just like a surgeon take their own judgment, the pathologists also have used to take their own judgments. It is ideally if a surgeon and pathologist can sit together, but that usually is not possible, especially in a busy country like India. So basically, our pathologist chooses the closest margin, or in some instances, the most suspicious margins.
I think your answer is good. You know, it depends. If you give us, someone's net isn't working well. I think Sharad.
So I want to make a comment, sir, Dr. Saurabh here.
Yeah, Saurabh.
Most of the times we would go personally and gross the tumor on table with the pathologist. And I would tell them that I am not sure about this particular margin, whether it is mucosal or a soft tissue. So they will pay more attention to that. And sometimes for a T1 tongue lesion, I would just orient and send. So in that case, they would do soft tissue and mucosa of all the four sides and a deeper soft tissue margin.
So Saurabh, I love the point that you've made that you would go into the pathology room. And I do that myself. And I'll tell you why. If you go into any pathology department, usually grossing is left to the junior most person on the team. Very often the senior pathologist is not around. You gross wrongly and you get a wrong margin and write it close. It gives a patient who doesn't need radiotherapy. It gives you anxious nights and it gives the patients and its family anxious. So I think, Saurabh, your point is well made. And Sharad's point is also equally good, that you'll only sample the margins that are suspicious or close. You as a surgeon, if you have a doubt, you'll go and ask for that margin and you leave it to the judgment of your pathologist, who will cross the sample with you, palpate the various margins, say, I think this is the closest, and would sample it. Any of you all use adjuncts or any experience of using adjuncts to decide whether your margin is clear, like narrow band imaging or anything like that?
No, sir.
Okay. So anyway, quickly, we'll end the margin story by, let me see if I have something to end. So there are adjuncts described, and this is a very classical paper, and I know there are a lot of juniors who are listening in. This is a paper from David Sedrensky from John Hopkins, who looked at P53. It's an old paper. It's in the 2000s. Basically looking at P53, making probes and doing it. But if you see, this is 30 head and neck cancer patients, 25 margins negative on histology, molecular assessment done. The 12 with the negative molecular were 12 without recurrence. Those with molecular positive margins on follow-up, 5 got recurrence. It's an old paper, but just to tell you that molecular markers is one thing that could be used. The second is fluorescence visualization guided local recurrence of oral squamous cell cancer, a JAMA 2020 paper. And if you look at, this is from the Canadian group, Alberta and various others. So basically a randomized controlled trial, 457 patients, 227 had fluorescence guided and 216 none. And if you see, the outcomes really were similar. So for us today, adjuncts is absolutely theoretical. It's something that you need to investigate, and it's not standard of care. So if you don't have it in your practice, you don't have to get panicky, and you're doing correct. I'd like to thank Dr. Richa for these two slides that I requested her to make. And if she is on the air, thank you very much for your help, as I was very busy this morning with my father not keeping too well. So thank you, Richa. Any comments from any of the panelists on margins, or we'll move on?
No, sir.
Lovely. Great. Issue three. This was asked of me, factors to decide on the approach. When do we involve the plastic surgeon? So these are two questions. One is, when will you do a per oral examination? When will you raid a cheek flap? Do any of y'all do mandibulotomy? So the first question is on the approach. Go ahead. Anybody answer? Rajiv, Yusuf, I've not heard your voice for a long time. Maybe Yusuf, you can take this.
Sir, if small lesion is there and interior lesions are there like tongue, then intraorally we can do surgery. And when like CA tongue, we can do intraorally. Small CA buccal mucosa, we can do intraoral surgery, sir.
Okay, so let us put it like this, so that our youngsters who are listening can, I totally agree. I don't think the size has anything to do with it. If it is at a place which is not accessible, right at the back in the retromolar, even if it is small, I may want to raise a cheek flap. So we'll say small lesions that are well accessible in all dimensions, in all directions, can be operated per orally, and in lesions in which you are not going to do the neck. In all other patients, you are going to operate the patient with the cheek flap. Now I'm rephrasing the second part. So if it's a per oral tongue excision and the lesion is going to be a second operation in the neck, I may not raise a cheek flap, but then my tolerance of raising a cheek flap may be slightly lower. I may want to raise the cheek flap to get proper clearance. But to rephrase again, or to repeat, small lesions accessible in all sites would be operated per orally. Would everybody agree on that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now I want to make a comment, and I want you all to, in the tongue, for small lesions, I would operate more than maybe 80-90% of them per orally. But in the buccal mucosa, I would only operate 10-20% orally. And I'll quote from a randomized trial of 500 patients that we published in New England Journal of Medicine. When we looked at buccal cancers, which is the number one cancer in our country, we only had 68 patients of the 500 of buccal mucosa with per oral. Though they were T1, T2 cancers, they were only 68, as opposed to 400, nearly 450 tongue cancers. And the reason is, invariably a buccal cancer will be close to the sulcus, upper or lower. It will be close to the retromolar. It's sometimes very difficult to assess the deep dimensions when you are operating per orally. These patients are associated with submucous fibrosis. And very often we have to put in a flap. If you put in a skin graft, it kind of shrinks, and it's very difficult to follow these patients. So again, my threshold for per oral is what should I say, very, I would do it for a tongue, but for a buccal, unless it's bang mid buccal, not going deeper than the buccinator, which is very rare, all those patients would have a cheek flap. Comments from the panelists, and otherwise we can move on.
What I feel, sir, that small lesions in buccal mucosa, we can do intraoral, sir, and then in such cases, usually we raise a small nasolabial flap. That do very good.
Sure. If you can get all the margins, it's a mid-buccal mucosa. I even sometimes put buccal. I also put buccal pad of fat if it's slightly posterior, and then put collagen on top. I don't put a graft anymore. So I agree with you, but I'm just cautioning the youngsters listening to us. The probability that you will do a per oral excision for buccal mucosa, yes, I'm not saying no, you will do it, but the number of cases will be much less than the number for tongue for the reasons that I have cited. How many of y'all do a mandibulotomy for your tongue early lesions?
No, sir.
No one does a mandibulotomy? So here's a case in point. I think this slide, Neeti, has to be thanked. Neeti, this is your slide. Am I correct?
Yes, sir. Okay.
So thanks, Neeti, for the slides that you also put for me to help me. Now, this has a buccal cancer. But say this patient had a lesion here somewhere in the tongue, which was a T1. Would you all still operate it close to the mandible? You all would still operate it per orally?
No, sir, with a cheek flap, doing a marginal mandibulectomy would be easy rather than do a mandibulotomy.
So I think that's a very, very, very good point. Who was that, Saurabh?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. So I totally agree with Saurabh. So a mandibulotomy, which we used to do earlier, has now kind of gone down because about 33%, 25 to 33% of mandibulotomies will have problems in union. So we rarely do it. So if you have a lesion, a patient has submucous fibrosis, the lesion is coming close to the bone, it's better to do a lingual plate marginal, raising a cheek flap, addressing the necks, having control per orally, cheek flap wise and inferiorly when you excise to get a clean margin. So I think mandibulotomy is going down occasionally. Can someone please mute themselves? Occasionally, we will do a mandibulotomy, but be very, very careful. You do a mandibulotomy, and then as you progress with the dissection, if you find it close to the bone posteriorly, you've really screwed the patient. You can't then do a marginal. Have a mandibulotomy cut in front, a marginal behind. The thing will just not heal. And in that case, you'll end up doing then a posterior segment or a segment. So be very careful. And I think Saurabh's point is well made, that raise the cheek flap, assess well, and probably do a lingual plate excision. Great. Which of y'all will send your early cancers to the plastic surgeon? And then I want Karnav to come in and tell us which ones he will fight for from these surgeons. Any of the surgeons, which ones will you all send to the plastic?
Sir, I would usually send if I am doing hemiglossectomy, or if the patient demands in a smaller defect based on his occupation, or if he wants to have a better voice. But most of the times, I would like to keep the tongue defect raw.
No, I'm not sure I'll agree with you. So if I'm doing a 1 centimeter T1 disease, I don't think by someone putting a flap in will give them a better voice, and even if the patient wants it. In fact, that big skin bit in the mouth will look horrible. It'll be bulging each time he smiles, you'll see it. Would there be any kind of a defect over which you would send your plastic 10% of the tongue volume, 20%, 30%, 40%, 50%?
Around 30, more than 30, 40%.
Okay. So I think that's a good point. About a third loss of tongue volume. The other criteria that I use is if I have significant portions of the floor of mouth that have been excised. You pull the remnant tongue to what's left a little behind of the floor of mouth, it anchors the tongue and you get horrible. In that case, I would put probably a radial. So it would be that. Any criteria on buccal?
Sir, any lesion near the angle of mouth and labial mucosa involving the lip area, then in those cases also we may need plastic surgery help.
Yeah, I think Rajiv, I just want to say I am leaning less and less on skin grafts in the oral cavity. They're horrible. They contract very poorly, very difficult to follow patients unless the lesion is above the buccinator. If it's buccinator and beyond, then you go beyond the buccinator, you leave the skin back and you put a graft there. It's horrible. You get skin puckering. You never know when you've got a recurrence. So again, of skin grafts, more of local flaps. We need now a buccal pad of flap, collagen. Occasionally, over the buccal pad, you can put a skin graft and a lot of radial forearms for a buccal when you take a 5-6 millimeter margin in all dimensions, including the base. Karna, your comments, please.
Yes, sir. So, like, if you look at the tongue, and if the defect is involving the floor of the mouth, then yes, definitely a flap is required. But I would think in such a way that you try to close the tongue defect which you have. And if your sutures leads to an inappropriate distortion of the remaining tongue, I feel a flap would be a better choice. And the second thing is that it also depends where the location of other tongue lesion is if the tongue defect is more posterior, then definitely you need to make sure that any sort of leak is avoided. In that instances, with a defect of the floor of the mouth for the tongue, definitely a flap is a better choice. Now, over the general concept on when a plastic surgeon is required, I feel that it gives a good freedom to the onco surgeon when they are excising. If they have in their mind that if a plastic surgeon is there, they can easily go and get a proper margin. Because if you feel that, you know, you have to call a plastic surgeon every time that you have to call them when it is planned, if a plastic surgeon is in-house with you, it would be better for you in the sense that you would be more radical in your excision rather than a more conservative approach. And I feel doing a conservative approach would be getting a closer margin and then getting into problems. Now, for the buccal mucosa, definitely, if you have a very small defect, which is posterior away from the commissure, sir, as you had told, a buccal fat pad with a collagen would be a better choice. But if you have a lesion which is involving the entire buccal mucosa, putting a skin graft alone doesn't heal because it would contract and heal, which would make even further examination difficult. In this instance, putting a flap and inserting the flap in full mouth opening and making sure that you don't put extra flap would give a nice functional outcome, which would even help the patient have a proper mouth opening after the surgery.
I totally agree with you. So I would also, I made this point very clear, Karnav, that I would also lean toward a flap in buccal cancers, and your points are well taken. I also...
Somesh here.
Yes, Sophia. Who is this?
Somesh here, can I make a comment?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead, Somesh.
Okay. I have a comment on Karnav's response. I think for buccal cancers, you have to give a lot of attention to reconstructing the sulci, because if the buccal, even the reconstructed buccal mucosa gets stuck to the alveolar mucosa, it becomes a big problem in post-op rehabilitation. And my second question is to all the panelists, would you ever go for a dental rehabilitation, dental implants or dentures for any of these patients? Because we are dealing with early cancers, and if so, when?
No. Say that again, Somesh. You want dental rehab, is it?
Yeah, dental rehab for because we are dealing with early cancers. Many of them would not be radiated, and so buccal cancers.
When it is early, why do you want to do dental? Why did you remove the teeth?
Yeah, but. We just saw that we would raise a cheek flap and do a marginal mandibulectomy for some of these patients.
So your question is very simple then. Do you all do dental rehab on a marginal mandible bone? That is the question. Otherwise, don't remove teeth in early cancers. early cancers don't need dental rehab. The question is very specific. If you've done a marginal mandible, can you do dental rehab?
Sir, can I counter your this thing? I would say sometimes if the lesion is very close to the GB sulcus or something, very probably you might not see a recurrence in the follow-up. So you would prefer to have the teeth off, especially if you feel that the patient is going to come back again with the recurrence.
Oh boy, this is getting more complicated. Now you want to remove teeth. Somesh wants to put in artificial teeth. Isn't this getting complicated? Neeti,
I don't want to put, I just wanted to know, is it worthwhile? And if yes, in which circumstances? Which are the teeth you would like to put back? Where does it work and where it doesn't?
Vinita, I was trying to bring you in with some radiation, but we're going to get stuck on teeth. Neeti, come on, go for it.
So like you said, for early oral cancers, I do not think there will be a requirement for removal of teeth, other than the fact that when you're doing a marginal mandibulectomy, after the marginal, depending upon the height of the mandible left, and if there is a good recess, one can definitely send it to the prosthodontist and go for dental rehabilitation.
It is my impression that replacing the posterior teeth does no good to the patient.
Say that again. Why do you say that, Somesh?
If you have removed the buccinator, then the chewing still remains a problem for them. The main value of replacing teeth are the teeth from canine to canine, because they support the lip and they help in chewing and eating definitely. A large study from Memorial of close to 1,800 patients, it was a retrospective study, confirms this, that when they replaced the posterior teeth, it didn't help the patients. It didn't improve the quality of life or feeding and oral rehabilitation. But replacing the anterior teeth is more important. If at all you have to do that.
So tell me, they had 1,700 patients in which they did not replace the posterior teeth?
I'll get back to you with the details of that case.
Let me tell you something. If the posterior teeth were not important, God wouldn't have given us molars and premolars. If you know that you chew your food, you grind your food with your molars and premolars, and your canines cannot do that job. I agree with you that it is good anteriorly. It supports the anterior arch. It's cosmetically better. But the canines have a different job. The incisors have a different job. And the molars have a different job. But I can quickly answer you. Post-marginal mandible, it's very difficult to do implants. It's not about the need. Anybody would want teeth if they've got the upper teeth there. But the size of implants usually are 10 to 11 millimeters. Now you get what are known as ultra short or short implants of 5 to 8 millimeters. Now surgeons, when you do a marginal mandible, your alveolar nerve will be sitting right there. You put any kind of implant, you're going to hit that nerve. So generally, post-marginal mandible, it's very difficult to do implants. Neeti's point was good, that look at the height of the residual. But remember that you also need to see that nerve, unless you have removed that nerve during your resection, in which case you've gone pretty low and you won't be able to put the implant. But whenever possible, you put it. But the dictum is that you don't do it on marginal. To answer Sharad's question, Sharad, if you have got decayed teeth, bad hygiene, you're not going to implant the lower jaw for whatever reason, then removing the upper jaw teeth makes sense. Because otherwise they migrate downwards and they cut into your flap. But otherwise, just don't be, removing.
Those 5%.
Yeah. But if the hygiene is bad and I feel it is going to cut into the flap, then in that case, I remove teeth. Otherwise, I just save teeth as much as possible. You never know. Sometimes they might get a second primary on the opposite palate and I need these teeth to anchor my prosthesis, my obturator. If I removed it at first surgery, there'll be no obturator for that patient. So don't remove unless required. Okay, great. I think we have passed time, but I don't know now how we are going to conclude this. I've hardly heard Vanita's voice on adjuvant radiotherapy. they are these soft indicators that Chaukar made an attention to. And I've put up four soft indicators, and I just asked Vanita to choose any one or two or make some concluding comments on how she would decide whether she wants to give adjuvant radiotherapy. Close margins, we've already discussed, maybe PNI, LVI, DOI, and single node.
So very difficult to choose any one of the factors, because it is generally the constellation of factors or multiple factors put together which decide whether a patient of early oral cancer needs post-operative adjuvant radiation therapy or not. But any patient who has node positive disease, even if it is a single node positive, generally would go for radiation therapy. As far as perineural invasion is concerned, it has to be further categorized whether it is a large nerve PNI or a small nerve PNI, whether it is a diffuse PNI versus it is a focal PNI. So a bad PNI, which means a large nerve PNI, perineural spread, or diffuse PNIs are the ones which would merit radiation therapy. And rest, for example, small intratumoral nerve PNI has to be seen in context of the other factors. So okay. I think it's difficult to say one factor, you know.
Yeah, so I agree with you. I'll end with that slide. I'm trying to look for it. But before that, I want to share with you all about depth of invasion. And this is something that we've just published. It's just out, I think, last week. And this is reanalysis of our N0 data. Depth of invasion in early oral cancers. Is it an independent prognostic factor? And we always believed it was not an independent prognostic factor. So this is on the entire cohort of 570 patients with a follow-up of 79 months. And we kind of staged them according to the old and then the new TNM staging, which is the 8th edition. Now look what happens to these patients. These are the elective NEC patients or the wait and watch. So when you look at the overall survival for the entire cohort, you can see that the graph nicely separates between the T1, the T2, and the T3. This is the new TNM staging. But when you look at the overall survival in the TND arm, you can see that the graph between the T1 and T2 separate. But if you do the elective neck dissection, then the depth of infiltration is not an independent prognostic factor. And you can see both the graphs overlapping each other. But statistically, it's not significant when you look at the interaction between the T stage and neck treatment. DOI is bad because when you have increasing DOI, you have bad prognostic factors, higher incidence of LVE, higher incidence of nodal, and that is why DOI is bad. And the same thing has come up in the Ibrahimi study, depth of invasion. These are the guys, the team that put DOI together. They looked at 1409 early oral cancers divided into less than 5, 5 to 10, more than 10 with presence of other adverse factors and survival outcome in relationship to post-op RT. And as you can see, they have bad factors. They have bad factors when they with increasing DOI. But when you look at outcomes, you can see that it's exactly the same. So in the subgroup without any adverse factors, DOI failed to demonstrate significant association with disease-specific survival, whether post-op RT was administered or not. So I just wanted to make some points. I've got a lot on single node positive. I've got on sentinel node, and I just feel 1 hour is just so short. But it's been fun doing this panel. If there are any questions, any comments. We'll do it because it's 7:46 and our star, Dr. Somesh, is waiting to speak. And I'm delighted to listen to his tips and tricks.
Can I ask a small question, sir? Dr. Saurabh here.
Yeah. Please, who are you asking it to me?
Sir, yes. Early tongue cancer, T2, N0, T2 based on the depth, whether it is 6 millimeter or 9 millimeter, without any other risk factors, would it warrant an adjuvant RT? Because depth of invasion 6 or 9 is different, but it is still T2.
Who is this? Vanita? Go ahead. Vanita?
He's asked this question to me several times in MDT and he's not satisfied with that answer. We work together. So he wants to hear from you probably.
Yes, sir.
Just if it's only a depth, so I'll go back to only a depth. Anyway, let me tell you, a single node positive, there's a lot of data and T2 does constitute not T1. Let me see if I can find something to supplement your answer. So let me put Justin Mann's paper up. NCDB analysis of 939 patients stage 1 oral cancer, looking at depth of invasion greater than 4 millimeters. So patients were stratified according to less than 4, greater than 4. These are pretty recent publications that I put. Receipt of post-op RT and management of neck, END versus observation. So you look what they find. Addition of post-op RT did not improve survival in tumors with DOI less than 4, as well as in DI more than 4, indicating that tumor DOI should not be used as a sole indicator to constituting post-operative RT. END improved survival for tumors that were greater than 4 millimeters, but not for those less than 4 millimeters. On multivariable analysis, END improved the OS for those more than 4. So basically, if you read the first point, DOI is not the slowing criteria. I showed you Ibrahami's paper, the guys who did the depth came out of this collaborative study. And here is his depth of invasion alone as an indication for post-operative radiotherapy in small oral cell carcinomas. 1409 patients divided into 3 sites. Read the bottom line in the subgroup without adverse DOI failed to demonstrate significant association with DSS. And I'm going to put another paper up for you, which is also relatively new, laryngoscope, looking at 126 P1, N0, oral cancers without any other risk factors. That means there was no node positive, no close margins, no positive, no PNI, this no significant difference with respect to DOI less than 4, greater than 4 in respect to local, regional and distant recurrences. Just look at the graphs overlapping. So for me, when I give post-operative, it's personalized post-operative treatment. And this is my philosophy. I look at a composite analysis of post-operative factors. The major factors we know are ECE, margin positive, minor factors. I put all of them up there. I would decide on a combination of factors. So if it's 6 millimeters, it's the only factor, T1 disease, margins clean, moderate grade, I would not give my patient post-op RT. Pooja and Vanita, if you all want to fight with me, do it now or better still do it offline. But that's my philosophy.
So you've shown very convincing data, sir. All these 4 papers have, you know, convincingly shown, and they all have a same conclusion that DOI does not alone merit post-operative radiation therapy. Would you give more weightage to PNI positivity, or is it always a constellation of factors, adverse factors?
You know, I have a lot of thing on PNI, but let's leave it for another panel. If I finish all my answers today, I won't get invited again. So I'll do this on another panel. But you must read Catherine Lippig's original article on PNI, where she discusses across all organs, and it's very, 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 very insightful. And I think Devendra made some points about intratumoral, large nerve, small nerve. Invariably, it's small nerve. That perineural spread of large nerves is in adenoid, cystic and others. It's very, very rare that you will have large nerves. It's always small nerves in oral cavity. Inferior alveolar, if that's involved and it's going up to ovale, that's a different story altogether. Otherwise, it's always small nerves. But again, PNI by itself, I may not want to give radiotherapy unless it's multiple. And I think all those points that Devendra made are well taken. But I'll save those comments for the next panel. I have some slides there, but I think we are well past time. It's nearly 6:00, and I think we'll hand back to the panelists.
Thank you.
to the organizers.
Thank you so much. I think that was a terrific panel discussion. I'm sure all our audiences and everyone has learned a lot. It was totally prolific. And if there is any questions from the participants, please feel free to put it down on the chat box, or you can post it on our group, and we will try to get answers for you from the panelists. We now move ahead with our next session, a very important scientific session, and I'll invite
Shruti, before we move on, Shruti, if I can put in a few words.
First,
I want to thank all the faculties to be here. But something that I want to show, if you can allow me to share the screen, I just want to show something which is something required for everyone after the surgery of the oral cavity. And this is a device which has been made by iCanCare. And if you will have a look at this, this is a TriScare. And most of the patients who have oral surgeries, they would have some sort of trismus, either because of submucosal fibrosis or because of the surgery. And something this one actually really helps our patient for opening up the oral cavity. So this is TriScare, and it I've been using it for quite some time, and maybe others who are here, esteemed, they can also use it, and it will be of real help to everyone, to your patients. And it is just 850 rupees as compared to the costly ones which is available in the market. And this is just a simple device and designed, and with the special material which is unbreakable material. So I just wanted to chip in this, and because this has been designed and made by me, so I thought I will take this advantage of this panel. Sorry for that, but I'm sure everyone will appreciate this, and will be it will be of use to each and everyone who is here on the set. Thank you, Shruti, for allowing me. And over to you, back to you.
Thank you so much. I think TriScare device is going to be really beneficial for everyone because it's very simple to use. And we'll talk more about it. But